Welcome all my dear students to Sudharma's physics classroom. Our board exams are coming and it is very very important to practice the previous year question papers. So as a part of that, I'm going to put a lot of classes on solving the previous year question papers, and today I'm going to solve the 2021 sample question paper. So it's very important to solve the sample question paper for the latest year, because that is through which we come to know what is the pattern of questions which are coming for our exam. So, from the science sample paper for 2021, today I'll be discussing the physics questions. Okay, so we will come to know what changes CBSE has made in the 2021 question pattern and what are the types of questions we are going to get. So, as you all of you know, the time for our exam is 3 hours and maximum marks 80. And out of which we have physics we have 26 marks. So remember, it's very very easy to score this complete 26 marks questions. When you see the questions, you come to know it's not at all difficult. It's all easy because we have already discussed all these kinds of questions in the classes. Okay, so already I have made a video on how to prepare for our CBSE board exams to get your good marks. I'll be giving the link in the description box. Okay, so without wasting time, let's directly get into the questions. So the question number 4 in the sample paper is physics. You know, you're going to write science exam and it will have physics, chemistry and biology questions. So I put the question number here so that when you get that question paper, if you are solving the question paper, you'll come to know, okay, we have solved this, right? That is why I put the real question number as per the question paper. So you can see the general instructions here. There are 4 parts, A, B, C and D. Okay. So when you approach the board exam, this is the first step. You have to read the instructions, read the general instructions, and which all sections you have to write all the answers, which sections you have to, you have choice, right? So all those things you have to read and understand carefully before starting of the exam. So question number 4 is physics. Why does the sun appear white at noon? It's a 1 mark question. And as you are well aware of the CBSE evaluation scheme, the keywords are important. See, after the study is learning is completed, we are done with the chapters, we are done with practicing the textbook exercises and all the extra questions. Now it is very important to learn or to know how to approach, how to write in the answer sheet. So the keyword is important. If the keyword is not there, you will not get any mark. So here the scattering is the keyword, scattering. Okay. So during noontime, light is least scattered. That is the answer you're expected to write. Okay. So you know that this is the reason why the sun appears white at noon. Now comes question number 5. That's again physics. Both a spherical mirror and a thin spherical lens have a focal length of minus 15 centimeter. What type of mirror and lens are these? The moment you see the term minus 15 centimeter, of course you have to understand, during the class also I discussed it, no matter it is a mirror or a lens, if the focal length is negative, then it is a concave. Okay, it's a concave mirror or concave lens. Focal length is negative. Okay. So this is the answer you have to write, and the board has given an alternative answer. So if a child writes plano concave lens, that also gets a credit, but definitely you are not aware of what is plano concave. You know only about concave lens in our syllabus, concave lens and concave mirror. Then no need to worry, because this is for those who has written, because I just kept the answer key as it is so that you will be aware of how the evaluation happens. That's very very important. This is from the marking scheme I have taken. Okay, so you have to write concave. So remember, focal length, when the focal length is negative, that is a concave mirror or concave lens. Both mirror and lens, if it is concave, focal length is negative. Now comes the 6th question. Image formed by a concave mirror is observed to be real, inverted and larger than the object. Where is the object? So definitely you can see over here. So this is there is a choice for this particular question. So in a if there is a question with choice, make sure you read both the questions properly. It's very important to read both the questions properly and decide, because decision making is important there. Because in the first reading, you may feel one question is easy, then you choose that. Later on, solving it, you may feel that, okay, this is not fine for me. You go ahead with the next one. So what happens is you lose time during that time. So make sure before starting writing, you make sure you are sure about the answer. Definitely, this is a one mark question. I'm sure this is a very easy question for you. Both questions are easy. So the question is real, inverted, and larger than the object. And it is a concave mirror. So concave mirror, we know that it forms real and virtual image. But real, inverted, and larger, real magnified image, where is the object placed? We know that when the object is between C and F, object between the center of curvature and the focus, image is formed beyond C and it is a real magnified image. So you can either choose that or name the part of a lens through which a ray of light passes without suffering any deviation. And definitely all of you know that answer, right? It is through the optical center. So here you have to write any one of the answers, okay? Because it's a choice questions, and never think that if you write both, you will get 2 marks. No, you will get only 1 mark. If you write both the answers. And the disadvantage is if you write both the answers, you are wasting time there. Because time management is very, very important in case of a board exam. Okay, so either choose first or second. Now coming to the 7th question. In the arrangement shown in figure, there are 2 coils wound on a non-conducting cylindrical rod. Initially, the key is not inserted in the circuit. Later, the key is inserted and then removed shortly after. What are the 2 observations that can be noted from the galvanometer reading? So, those who are thorough with the NCERT textbook, they are well aware of this picture. So, this is on electromagnetic induction. And this experiment, we can observe that when we switch on the circuit, there is momentary deflection in the galvanometer. And if you switch off the circuit, then again there is a deflection, but it is in the opposite way. So you have to write that there are momentary galvanometer deflections that die out shortly. The deflections are in opposite directions. So you are going to get 1 mark. Hope you understood the answer. Now, coming to the 8th question. Draw the magnetic field lines around a straight current carrying conductor. Very, very easy question. Draw the magnetic field lines around a straight current carrying conductor. So, what is to be noted here? When you draw this diagram especially, you need to be very careful. It's a very easy diagram. So, we know that around straight current carrying conductor, the magnetic field are concentric circles. So, when they are concentric circles, we have to draw circles, and the center should be at the conductor, wherever the conductor is. But when you draw a magnetic field, you are expected to draw the direction, because magnetic field has direction. So you have to make sure you are drawing the direction of current. Accordingly, you have to put the arrows of the magnetic field. So here in this diagram, I have put the direction of current in the upward direction. So using the right hand thumb rule, we know that the magnetic field is in the anti-clockwise direction when you apply the right hand thumb rule. So, yes, suppose in your diagram, if you are marking the current in the downward direction, you have to put the arrows in the opposite way. That's it. So you're going to get 1 mark, and in that evaluation scheme, the arrows, if the arrows are not there, you will not get marked there. Remember that always. Okay. Now coming to another 1 mark question, here also you have choice. 2 unequal resistances are connected in parallel. If you are not provided with any other parameters, example, numerical values of I and R, what can be said about the voltage drop across the 2 resistors? 2 unequal resistances are connected in parallel. If you are not provided with any other parameters, that means if the values are not given, that means here they have given the example also. The question is very clear. Numerical values of I and R. If it is not given, what can be said about the voltage drop across the two resistors? Question is crystal clear. We have to talk about the voltage drop across the two resistors. And we know that very well. When resistors are connected in parallel, then the potential difference will be same through both the resistors. That means the voltage drop is same across both. You are going to get 1 mark. Easily you can get 1 mark. Some work, so the next question is this OR question. Some work is done to move a charge Q from infinity to a point A in space. The potential of the point A is given as V. What is the work done to move this charge from infinity in terms of Q and V? So this is one of the initial equations of the chapter electricity. We define electric potential V is equal to W by Q, or W is equal to V multiplied by Q. Very, very simple. You don't have to explain anything here. See, this is the answer key given. This is the evaluation scheme given. We just have to write W is equal to QV. Because the question is, what is the work done to move this charge from infinity in terms of Q and V? That's it. W is equal to Q multiplied by V. Okay. Now, after that, we have chemistry and bio questions. See, after this is question number 9. And this is a new pattern of question introduced. And they're going to give paragraphs. Maybe if you have already written the pre-boards, you will be aware of this now. So a paragraph will be given, and under that 5 questions will be given, and you have to choose 4 questions. It's MCQs, you don't have to worry. See, you are very familiar with the comprehension questions in language, right? But here the scientific terms are there, and do not worry that I have not learned this, I have not seen this kind of a telescope or whatever it is. So they clearly explains, it's purely based on the concepts we have studied. So first, let us read the question. Sumati wanted to see the stars of the night sky. She knows that she needs a telescope, okay, to see the distant stars. She finds out that telescopes which are made of lenses. These are the important terms you have to underline when you read it, or you keep it in mind, are called refracting telescopes. We don't know what questions are waiting for us. So, without wasting time, because again, when you come back and read it, your time will be lost. So, this is the best method you can do when you start reading the paragraph. Make sure all the important words are there in your mind. They are called refracting telescopes, and the ones which are made of mirrors are called as reflecting telescopes. So, we understand that there are two types of telescopes, refracting telescopes, which are made of lenses, and reflecting telescopes, which are made of mirrors. She decided to make a refracting telescope. So definitely we know that in the paragraph it is said that refracting telescopes are made of lenses. So Sumati want to make a refracting telescope. That's the conclusion here. She bought 2 lenses, L1 and L2. You can see that in the diagram, L1 and L2. Out of which L1 was bigger and L2 less smaller. The larger lens gathers and bends the light, while the smaller lens magnifies the image. Okay, the larger lens gathers and bends the light, while the smaller lens magnifies the image. Big, thick lenses are more powerful. Thick lenses are more powerful. So, to see far away, she needed a big, powerful lens. Unfortunately, she realized that a big lens is very heavy. Heavy lenses are hard to make and difficult to hold in the right place. Also, since the light is passing through the lens, the surface of the lens has to be extremely smooth. Any flaws in the lens will change the image. It would be like looking through a dirty window. So this is the paragraph. Now we are going to the questions. We have 5 questions and we're going to answer 4 questions. So here we will be answering all the questions. We'll be discussing all the answers. But in the exam, you have to write only 4 questions. 4 marks. Easily you can score 4 marks. Based on the diagram shown, what kind of lens would Sumati need to make the telescope? So it is mentioned in the paragraph, she needs to make a refracting telescope. and refraction, we need lenses. And it is clearly mentioned in the paragraph, and in the diagram also we can see two convex lenses. So we can go ahead with the option where convex lens is given. So option B, convex lenses. Easily one mark in your pocket. Question number 2. If the powers of the lenses L1 and L2 are in the ratio of 4:1, what should be the ratio of the focal length of L1 and L2? So this is a very easy question. Power P is equal to reciprocal of focal length. So P1 will be equal to 1 by F1 and P2 will be equal to 1 by F2. So if you take P1 by P2, they have given the power of lenses are in the ratio 4:1. So P1 by P2 is equal to 4:1. That is as per the question. 4:1. So P1 by P2 means as per the equation 1 by F1 divided by 1 by F2. That means it is equal to F2 divided by F1. F2 divided by F1 is 4:1. So their ratio L1 focal length is F1. So F1 by F2 is equal to 1 by 4. The ratio is going to be 1:4. And this much calculation is not required for an MCQ. I am solving it here for your understanding purpose. So what we have to do here, how do we think? When it is an MCQ question, we have to answer it very quick. So when we have to answer it very quick, we know that the focal length and power are related, like they are inversely proportional, right? So when it is inversely proportional, when the powers are in the ratio 4:1, the focal length will be in the ratio 1:4, that's it. Okay. Now moving on to the third question. What is the formula for magnification obtained with a lens? What is the formula for magnification? Of course, you will be knowing the formula for magnification. But let's see all the options and we have to choose the correct one. Best one. MCQs are very tricky because we will have to choose the best option. So first option, ratio of height of the image to the height of the object. Of course, we know that magnification is HI divided by HO. Double the focal length, inverse of the radius of curvature, inverse of object distance. All the other options are wrong. Only the option A is correct. Easily, one more mark. Now, Sumadhi did some preliminary experiment with the lenses and found out that the magnification of the eyepiece is 3. If in her experiment with L2, she found an image at 24 cm from the lens, at what distance did she put the object? So what is given here? The magnification of the eyepiece, that means that smaller lens, that is 3. So M is equal to 3. Right? A magnification formula is M is equal to V by U. So 3 is equal to, if her experiment with L2, she found an image at 24 cm. So image distance is 24 divided by U. At what distance did she put the object? So U is equal to 24 divided by 8. 24 divided by 3. So this is going to be 8 cm. So you will be wondering, I have not put the signs here, right? And you can see in the option also, there is no sign, right? So here we are just logically thinking and answering, because the image formed by the first lens, right, that will act like the object for the second lens. Okay. So object distance is going to be 8 centimeters. Now coming to the fifth question. So among these 5 questions, you have to choose only 4. So this is easy because you have a choice, right? You have a choice. So even you can go back to the paragraph. This is based on the paragraph. Other things are based on our knowledge on lenses. And this is based on the paragraph. Sumadhi bought not so thick lens for the telescope and polished them. What advantages, if any, would she have with her choice of lenses? Sumadhi bought not so thick lenses for the telescope. Hope you remember in the paragraph, they are talking about the thickness and what are the disadvantages of the thickness, right? That is why she bought not so thick lens for the telescope and polished them. What advantages, if any, would she have with her choice of lenses? So Let's see the options. Option A, she will not have any advantage as even thicker lens would give clearer images. Thicker lenses would have made the telescope easier to handle, definitely not. Not so thick lenses would not make the telescope very heavy and also allow considerable amount of light to pass. Not so thick lenses will give her more magnification. So what is the correct option? They would not make the telescope very heavy. We have read that clearly in that paragraph. They are not that heavy. Thick lenses are heavy. It's not convenient, right? And it allow considerable amount of light to pass, not so thick lenses. So we have to go ahead with the option C. So understand the pattern here. The four questions are from based on our knowledge. And the fifth question is from the paragraph. Okay, so the comprehension part, if you read it properly, you can score easily 1 mark. Other things, definitely you know all those things. So no need to worry. Full mark, you can aim full mark from this area. And this is an advantage of this year. And you get one more question. And it depends, okay, this model question paper, they have given two physics questions. And it doesn't mean we will have only physics questions here. You can expect chemistry or bio questions like this. Okay, now read the following and answer any four questions from 20 to 21 to 25. So let's read the question, read the paragraph. A solenoid is a long helical coil of wire through which a current is run in order to create a magnetic field. The magnetic field of the solenoid is the superposition of the fields. So superposition, this word is to be noted, because we don't know what questions are waiting for us. So the magnetic field of the solenoid is the superposition of the fields due to the current through each coil. It is nearly uniform inside the solenoid and close to zero outside and is similar to the field of a bar magnet having a north pole at one end and a south pole at the other depending upon the direction of current flow. The magnetic field produced in the solenoid is dependent on a few factors such as the current in the coil, number of turns per unit length, etc. The following graph is obtained by a researcher while doing an experiment to see the variation of the magnetic field with respect to the current in the solenoid. The unit of magnetic field is given in graph dash is in milli Tesla and the current is given in amperes. So I'm very sure you will be tensed about this word milli Tesla. Do not worry. It is the unit of the magnetic field. So magnetic field B is given in milli Tesla and current is given and along x-axis and it is measured in amperes. But what we have to note here is what is the shape of the graph? It is a straight line. So when you get a straight line graph with an increase in slope, right? This is a linear relation, right? There is a direct proportionality. Current and magnetic field. There is a direct proportionality. That is what we have to understand. Now let's move on to the questions. What type of energy conversion is observed in a linear solenoid? Mechanical to electric, mechanical to magnetic, electrical to magnetic, electrical to mechanical, magnetic to mechanical. So energy conversion observed in a solenoid. We know that in a solenoid, electrical energy to magnetic energy, to the magnetism, right? Electrical energy is converted into magnetic. But how do we answer this question? Most of you will be feeling the answer is B. No, it's not B, because during the conversion of this energy, electrical energy, when it is electricity is passed through the solenoid in a linear solenoid, so the motion of the electrons will be happening there, right? When a current passes through it. So it creates a mechanical energy. So electrical to mechanical energy is the answer here. Now question number 20. What will happen if a soft iron bar is placed inside the solenoid? Everyone knows this answer. So what happens before looking into the options? Let's keep our answer in our mind. What will happen if a soft iron bar is placed inside a solenoid? Definitely there will be an increase in magnetic field, right? Increase in the strength of the magnetic field. So now let's check what is the option. The bar will be electrocuted resulting in short circuit. No. The bar will be magnetized as long as there is current in the circuit. Definitely yes. The bar will be magnetized permanently? No, because soft iron will lose its magnetic property once the current is removed. And the bar will not be affected by any means. If it is not affected by any means, there is no need for putting the solenoid inside that, right? So, we know that the magnetic field strength will be increasing, and it is because the soft iron bar will be magnetized as long as the current is there in the circuit. So, answer is B. Okay, so answer is B here, and here it is C. Now, moving on to the next question. Question number 3. The magnetic field lines produced outside the solenoid, magnetic field lines produced inside the solenoid are similar to that of a, which one you will be choosing? Let's read all the options. We cannot directly jump into the answer. A bar magnet, a straight current carrying conductor, a circular current carrying loop, electromagnet of any shape. No, different shaped electromagnets will have different shaped magnetic fields. So definitely we know that a solenoid produces a magnetic field very similar to that of a bar magnet, option A. Question number 4. Remember, here also you have to choose only 4 questions. 4 answers you have to write. Okay. Now question 4 on subdivision 4 on question 20. After analyzing the graph, a student writes the following statements. The magnetic field produced by the solenoid is inversely proportional to the current. See the graph here. We are seeing the magnetic field and current. We are getting a straight line graph, and the slope of the graph is increasing. So we can say, so here see the options here. Only 4, 1 and 3, 1 and 3 and 4, 1 and 2, only 2. So we have to eliminate and choose the options very wisely. Okay. The magnetic field produced by the solenoid is inversely. No, it is not inversely. It is a direct proportionality. Now, the magnetic field produced by the solenoid is directly proportional to the current. This is correct. The magnetic field produced by the solenoid is directly proportional to the square of the current. If it is square of the current, then we will not get that straight line graph. The graph shape will be different. So, this is also wrong. The magnetic field produced by the solenoid is independent of the current. Never. Because it is depending on the current, that is what we have seen from the graph. So, we have seen only option 2 is correct. So, directly we can go to the answer D. So, here D is the correct answer. This is what I am saying. You can easily score 4 plus 4. 4 in the previous one and 4 here also. Now, from the graph, deduce which of the following statements is correct. So, we need the graph here. So, for a current of 0.8 ampere, the magnetic field is 13 millitesla. So, let's see that. For a current of 0.8 ampere, so you need not worry about millitesla, what is that millitesla and all. We just have to see the value from the graph. For a current of 0.8 ampere, the magnetic field is 13 millitesla. Let's see that. 0.8 ampere. So, 0.8 is here, right? So, 0.8 is here. And so we have to check other options also. I'm just taking the first one. So for 0.8, we are getting the magnetic field here. So here we have 12, right? This is 12. So this is going to be 13. 13 and 14, right? So the first option is correct. This option is correct. So let's see the other options. For larger currents, the magnetic field increases non-linearly? No. For a current of 0.8 ampere, the magnetic field is 1.3 millitesla. No, it is 13 millitesla. There is not enough information to find the magnetic field corresponding to 0.8 ampere current. Definitely clear values are given in the graph. So, this is 13. This is actually 13 because the graph is meeting at the midpoint of 12 and 14. So, definitely as per the scale, it is 13. So, you can easily get 4 marks in this question also. So this is the advantage for this year 2021 students. You get this kind of paragraph questions. Very easily you can score marks. Now again you have chemistry and bio questions. And here comes the 25th question. Again it is physics. A student observes the above phenomenon in the lab as a white light passes through a prism. It's white light. Among many other colors, he observed the position of the two colors, red and violet. What is the phenomenon called? What is the reason for the violet light to bend more than the red light? So white light passing through a prism and the colors are coming red on the top and violet at the bottom. Definitely the phenomenon is dispersion. I have kept the marking scheme here to make you understand how the mark distribution happens in the board exam. If you write it is dispersion, you get one mark. Now, what is the reason for the violet light to bend more than the red light? So during dispersion, we know that this bending is happening because of the difference in speed for different colors, right? So red travels the fastest and violet travels the with the lowest speed in any other transparent medium. And in air or vacuum, all the colors will be traveling with the same speed. Okay. So speed of violet light inside the prism is slowest and that of red is highest. Hence, deviation of violet light is maximum, that of the red and that of the red and red deviation for red color is minimum. So the see, you don't have to be very, you don't have to stick to the same sentence. The concept is the speed is different. So when the speed is different, the refractive index will change. So refractive index is inversely proportional to the speed of light. So accordingly, the bending happens. So that is why the reason violet has the lowest speed inside the prism and the bending will be maximum for violet color. Now coming to the 26th question. A student has two resistors, 2 ohm and 3 ohm. She has to put one of them in place of R2 as shown in the circuit. The current that she needs in the entire circuit is exactly 9 ampere. So by calculation, which of the two resistors she should choose? The student has two resistors, 2 ohm and 3 ohm. She has to put, this is a 2 mark question. She has to put one of them in place of R2. R2, there is no resistor put, but she has 2 ohm and 3 ohm. So the current that she needs in the entire circuit is exactly 9 ampere. So by calculation, which of the two resistors she should choose? So total current needed is 9 ampere and average the voltage given here in the diagram is 12 volt. So the total current in the circuit, we know that as per Ohm's law, total current is V by I, V is 12 and current, as per the question, the total current is 9. So the total resistance of the circuit is going to be 12 by 9 or 4 by 3 ohm. And when you connect two resistors in parallel, you have to get this 4 by 3. So when two resistors are connected in parallel, we know that R is equal to R1 R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So this R, instead of this R, this is the total resistance, you have to put 4 by 3. So 4 by 3 is equal to, already R1 is 4, right? So 4 R2 divided by 4 plus R2. So now you cross multiply that, 4 into 4 plus R2 is equal to 12 R2. Right? So 16 plus 4 R2 is equal to 12 R2. So 16 is equal to 12 minus 4, 8 R2, or R2 will be equal to 16 by 8, you will be getting 2 ohms. So you have to choose 2 ohm. So that is what is given here. This is the answer key given by the board. That is why I kept it here. So if you write all these calculations, because steps carries mark here because it's a 2 mark question. Okay, so 4 R2 by 4 plus R2 is equal to, the idea is you are identifying the voltage is same for both the resistors and the total current will be split, and total current is given as 9 ampere, and you are identifying the equation as the parallel combination equation, that is nothing but R1 R2 by R1 plus R2. Now let's move on to the next question, that is the 33, question number 33. That comes in physics. All the remaining questions are from chemistry and bio. Now question is, refractive index of water with respect to air is 1.33 and that of diamond is 2.42. Okay, refractive index of water with respect to air is 1.33 and that of diamond is 2.42. In which medium does the light move faster, water or diamond? So this is a common type of question. How do we answer this? We know that refractive index is inversely proportional to speed. So here, the refractive index of water, is 1.33. Refractive index of diamond is 2.42. So in which medium does the light move faster? When light has to move faster, the refractive index should be less. So this here is the answer for you. So let's analyze what are the steps they are expecting from us in the exam sheet. Refractive index is equal to speed of light in vacuum divided by speed of light in medium. That is, mu is equal to C by V. Since refractive index of diamond is more, hence the speed of light is lesser in diamond. So question is in which one, right? Which one the light move faster? Okay. So faster movement is where the refractive index is less. Okay, so the speed is less in diamond and more in water. Now, what is the refractive index of diamond with respect to water? Refractive index of diamond with respect to water. So when we have to do that, we have a formula. We can even derive that formula. We know that refractive index is equal to C by V. Right? So, refractive index of diamond with respect to water. Refractive index of diamond with respect to water. You learn the formula that is equal to refractive index of diamond divided by refractive index of water. So, this you can see in the previous year question papers also. Similar type of question was asked in the previous year question papers also. It may not be with diamond in water. I remember it is with glass in water. So this is the formula for calculating the relative refractive index. Refractive index of diamond with respect to water is refractive index of diamond divided by refractive index of water. So that will be equal to refractive index of diamond. That's absolute refractive index of diamond. That is 2.42 divided by 1.33. So you will be getting approximately 1.82. Refractive index doesn't have any unit. Always remember that. Now, our next question is question number 36. And this is a 5-mark question. And you have a choice here. So, first we will solve this question and then go to the next one, which comes as a choice. So, in the given circuit, A, B, C and D are 4 lamps connected with a battery of 60 volt. You can see that in the diagram. Analyze the circuit to answer the following questions. What kind of combination are the lamps arranged in? Series or parallel? So when you look at the diagram, you can see that from the positive of the battery, one connection is going to each lamp, that is going through the switch. And from the negative, another connection is going to the lamp, right? So definitely this is a parallel connection. So the first answer is parallel. So you get 1 mark here. Directly you will get 1 mark. Now, explain with reference to your above answer, what are the advantages, any two, of this combination of the lamps? So there is a danger hidden in this question. See, by mistake, if you identified this connection as series, right? If by mistake, if you write that, then the second answer also goes wrong. So be very careful in answering in this kind of questions. Explain with reference to your above answer. So the second answer should be based on the first answer. So here we have chosen it as parallel, and in parallel combination, we know that voltage will be given equally and current will be given according to the device preference, because in a household circuit, parallel connection, different devices will be there using different current. They will be requiring different amount of current. So their required amount of current can be given if it is in parallel. And if one of the devices goes faulty, then the other devices are not affected because it is parallel. Each device is working on individual switches. So you can just write any of those two advantages. Okay. Now explain the proper calculations. Which lamp glows the brightest? Which lamp will be glowing the brightest? So we need the calculation, with proper calculation we have to check. So what is the power rating? We have to calculate, we have to see the power rating. So voltage is 60 and current is given, and we know that P is equal to VI, and the bulb with more power will be brightest. So in this we have see, voltage is constant, right? So when voltage is constant, the devices with the higher current rating will be having more power rating. So we can say that 5 into 60, right? 5 into 60. So for the bulb with current of 5 ampere, that is bulb C, 300 watts, power of this is power of bulb C. So power of A is going to be 3 into 60, that is 180 watts. Now power of B is 4 into 60, so 240, because we need proper calculations. Power of C already calculated. Power of D is again 3 into 60, 180 watts. So the answer is this, because the bulb C, right? So explain with proper calculation which lamp glows the brightest. So the lamp which is C, it has a higher current rating, that will be glowing the brightest. Now find out the total resistance of the circuit. How will you find out the total resistance of the circuit? So you'll be worried that the resistance of each lamp is not given, only current is given. But for that we have the total current. We can find out the total current, right? What is the total current? Total current I is equal to 3 plus 4 plus 5 plus 3. So 12 plus 5 is 17, 17 plus 3. So 3 plus 4 7 7 plus 5 12 12 plus 3 15 amperes. So 15 ampere will be the total current. So total resistance R will be equal to total voltage divided by total current. Voltage is 60 and total current is 15. So you don't have to worry that the device resistances are not given, and you'll be thinking the answer is 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2, right? 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3 plus etc. But this way also we can find out the total resistance. So 60 by 15, you will be getting 4 ohms. Remember to write the proper units here. So here you are going to get 5 marks if you do like this. And the last question. So this is OR question. Okay, see, question 36, first one or this one. So you will be able to answer any one of this. So make sure you read the question properly. Now, all of you, whoever has practiced the NCERT exemplar question, will be able to answer this question immediately, because this is the same NCERT exemplar question. PQ is a current carrying conductor in the plane of the paper as shown in the figure below. Find the directions of the magnetic fields produced by it at points R and S. So let's do it one by one, because it's a 5-mark question. It's a long answer question. So find the directions of the magnetic field produced by it at points R and S. So here the current is moving in the upward direction. So we have to apply the right hand thumb rule. Thumb in the direction of current, wrap around the conductor with the other fingers. So you will be getting the direction of magnetic field. That is our right hand thumb rule. So when you do that, you can see that you will be getting an anti-clockwise magnetic field here. But how do you answer this particular question? Find the direction of the magnetic fields produced by it at points R and S. So how we are going to draw the diagram, if you have to draw here, you don't have to draw the diagram, but for your understanding, I'm saying. So you have to just take your pen or pencil, keep your thumb in the upward direction over the pen, then wrap around the conductor. So R is on the right side. R is here, right? This is R. So when we have an anti-clockwise magnetic field, so here it's going to be into the plane. At R, it is into the plane. And at S, our fingers will be trying to come out of it, right? So it is out of the plane. So here comes the answer key. The magnetic field lines produced is into the plane of the paper at R, and out of it at S. If you write this, you are going to get 1 mark very easily. Now, given R1 is greater than R2, where will the strength of the magnetic field be larger? Give reasons. R1 is greater than R2. So definitely we know that when the position, right, that is nearby the conductor, the places where it's nearby the current carrying conductor, the strength of the magnetic field will be more. So even if it is, it looks R1 is greater than R2, right? They have given a clarification. R1 is greater than R2. Where will the strength of the magnetic field will be larger? Magnetic field strength will be larger at S because R2 is less than R1. So nearby the conductor, the magnetic field will be more. So the field at S is greater than the field at P. So for identifying that, you get one mark. For the explanation, you will be getting another one mark. Now question 3. If the polarity of the battery connected to the wire is reversed, how would the direction of the magnetic field be changed? So when we know that when the polarity of the battery reverses, the direction of current will be changing. So here they have shown the direction of current in the upward direction. So if the polarity of the battery is changed, then the direction of current will be downward. Accordingly, initially the magnetic field at R was into the plane. Now what happens? The magnetic field at R is going to be out of the plane. It is going to be just the reverse of the first answer we have given. At S, it is going to be into the plane. So let's look at the answer key. The current will be going from top to bottom in the wire shown, and the magnetic field lines are now in the clockwise direction on the plane, which is perpendicular to the wire carrying current. Now, explain the rule that is used to find the direction of the magnetic field for a straight current carrying conductor. Here, be very, very careful. Most of the students will write it as right-hand thumb rule. But the question is, explain the rule that is used to find out. If the question is, what is the rule? State the rule or name the rule which is used to find out the magnetic field direction. It's not. This is explain the rule. So we are expected to explain the right-hand thumb rule. So the rule we have used is right-hand thumb rule. The thumb is aligned to the direction of the current, and the direction in which the fingers are wrapped around the wire will give the direction of magnetic field. So here comes the end of physics questions. And when you see these questions, definitely you understand that there is no difficult questions. And moreover, the advantage is those paragraph kind of questions where you can score full marks. And not much numericals also, if you have observed, right? Only one or two numericals were there. So hopefully the board exam questions also come like this. So what you have to do is carefully analyze. You have to check the chemistry and biology questions also. Make sure you are able to practice it within the time limit. And if you have any doubts, please put it in the comment box. I am happy to explain it again if you want. And make it a habit. Now we have 3 months. Make it a habit of practicing the question papers within the time limit. So take any previous year question paper and start writing in that 3 hour time pattern. You start writing it. And in the next class, I will be coming with 2020 question paper discussion. So at least 10 years question papers we have to solve before the exam. Okay. So very soon I'll be coming with the 2020 question paper explanation. And before that, make sure you practice all these questions. And if you are new to the channel, please subscribe to the channel and click the bell icon for more classes. And till the board exams, we will be discussing the previous year question answers now onwards. And definitely it is going to give you the best result. Okay, so see you soon with another question paper, another previous year question paper. Thank you for watching. Bye.